Okay, guys, good afternoon, everybody, and welcome to a review of 2.5 Dimensional Seduction. We are now covering episode 17. 17 episodes. This is a big deal. I mean, I haven't made a lot of views like this since Rise of the Shield Hero at the time, and it was a lot of episodes. Now, throughout the episodes of 2.5 Dimensional Seduction, we have seen every character development. There are motives and reasons for people who, for them liking cosplaying. And there's a reason why everybody loves cosplaying. And there's, as I watch every episode of this, it comes to my attention that it's not just about cosplaying, and it's not just about the friendship. You know, cosplay brings friendships, cosplay bring the confidence in you, but it's always a backstory. Every character we have seen in 2.5 Dimensional Seduction has always given us a sad backstory. Every character that has a sad backstory is that cosplay gives them love. Cosplay brings out everything in you. Like me, for example, anime was the reason why I talk video, why I go to conventions and meet new people. If it wasn't for anime, I'd be somewhere else. This is why I love anime. This is why I like doing videos. It's because of stuff like this. I'm looking at 2.5 Dimensional Seduction, and I realize every character is going through so much just finding that one passion that makes you want to love cosplaying. In Aria's case, it's sad. This whole arc right now that we're in is Aria's love for cosplaying, but also a backstory that I never expected and a cliffhanger that I never expected. So without further ado, let's get right to the review of 2.5 Dimensional Seduction, episode 17. Okay, let's talk about this. Aria's backstory. You know, it's very hard to see a backstory like this, especially Aria, especially a gal like her, who I believe she's better than Kitagawa, but that's a different topic in another way. Aria's backstory. After last week, we found out her father was a manga artist, manga creator. I call it like it is. They're both the same for me. We find out her backstory before she was a gal. Like, her backstory is something like this. When she was a kid and she had black hair, her mom was the blonde hair. Her father had black hair. So that kind of like explaining how she got the blonde hair in the first place, how she became the gal in the first place. When she was a kid, all she wants is to draw her favorite character. The father didn't want to draw anything else. I mean, he did draw a daughter, drew a picture of her, but she's like, no, I don't want this. I want it for... And to her, she was her biggest fan. She was her biggest fan. Can you imagine if your father was a manga creator and you're like your number one, you'll be his number one fan because you cherish the work, the manga, that your father did, that your father has done for. Now, for the father's case, it hasn't been published. It hasn't been recognized because this manga, to him, is like, this is trash. Because he can't keep up with the other manga artists to a point where the editorials don't want his work. They don't want nothing. It's like, his work is so trash. So trash show that nobody don't want to read his mangas. Can you imagine? Can you imagine there's one manga that's published and you don't want to read it? Of course, for me, I don't like JoJo. I would never read a JoJo manga because that shit is trash. But that's a different topic. I would have read his mangas over JoJo's. But again, I stood my point. But I digress from my point here. Anyway, one night Aria's mother and father was arguing about the bills and about how his work ethics are and how he has no, like, nothing to do. Like, every opportunity he does is just editorial. They do not want him. He's felt like he's fallen off a cliff. Nobody didn't want his work. And then when he grabbed Aria's book, that the first book that he ever, the manga that he created, he's like, this is trash. This is freaking trash. Can I borrow this for a second? I want to use this. I'm going to use my notepad as example. This work that I've done is fucking trash. That's the thing. And then Aria as a kid saying, I hate you. I hate you as a manga artist. Like, damn. you know, I won't feel, I'm dead ass. I don't feel bad for her saying that. Because you gotta understand, Aria loves her father. Aria loves her being a monk creator. And she loves the work that she put on the table, that he put on the table. It's like, it may be a bad manga, a bad anime, but it's still your father's work. And cherish it forever. That's what I say. So I don't blame her for saying, but they got divorced at the age of, they got divorced when she was 6 years old. So she's staying with her mom. Okay. That explains how the mom got the blonde hair, is that. But still, father just disowned him, don't even care. All he does is work, don't even give a fuck. Not giving two shits about it. You know what I mean? That's that. But I'm glad that Aria has opened up to her friends. Now that she has friends, she's opened up. And Mikari, she came back because they're going to the biggest convention ever, Summer Convention. I can't say the name right, but this biggest convention is like Anime Expo. This biggest convention that they're going to is like WrestleMania. You go once a year to the biggest event of everybody's dreams. Yeah, I know there's Comic-Con, San Diego Comic-Con, and there's Anime Expo, which I believe is the biggest number one convention. Like, that's the WrestleMania, you know. But this convention in Japan, the Summer Comic-Con, I can't pronounce that name, but I think I said it right. That, I've seen a lot in anime. That is the biggest convention ever in Japan, the way I see it. But that's their next goal. And for that, they need a fourth person. And who is the fourth person that's joining? No surprise, the MC's childhood friend. Now, I like the childhood friend. She's been off screen for some time now. She's been off screen. We haven't seen her since, like, I could be wrong, but the last time we seen her was when, like, maybe 2 weeks ago, two episodes ago, when she like, hey, I'm going to give up on cosplaying. I'm going to try, give up mine and just try on cosplaying. So she did her research on cosplaying. The only reason she's doing cosplaying is for the love of the MC, because they're childhood friends. Okay, saying, at least they still kept the story with her liking the MC. But we all know the MC's into 2D girls. He done. And that's whole segment with the chocolate thing. Look, say what you want. This MC is so bold that he'll take a bullet for a 2D girl. Can you think about it? It's like, asking him, would you rather take $1 million or take a 2D girl? You know what he's gonna say? 2D girl. That's the message he gets. No matter how many punches you throw at him, would you rather give him this? Would you rather give him that? He'll still pick the 2D girl regardless. Now, Aria, you know, okay. Oh, by the way, I left off. Before I get back to Aria, let's keep going. I like how these four are communicating. These four are having a great time. And the MC now got four girls in his anime club. He's already, I know people don't think it's a harem, but it's already a harem. I mean, like, he got four freaking girls. He got Ririsa, who a Lily fan through the core and love cosplaying. You got one who's the childhood friend who dedicated, who becoming to be just like Lily, just for the MC. You got one girl who's very, Nona, who started out shy but able to make friends, and she's speaking more. And then you got a gal who loves anime, old school anime, and because of her father. So it's like, all these four have a reason for cosplay. And that's what I like about them. These four have a love for cosplay and they have their reasons. That's what I like about 2.5 Dimensional Seduction. These four have reasons to cosplay and they strive for their goal to be as why they want to be cosplaying. I like that. I really do. Now, I also like the fact that the whole restaurant scene with all four are eating. Yo, Ririsa and Aria, when they were eating, it was like, I'm looking at those two just eating food. Like, I'm looking at it from a Goku and Vegeta. You're like, you know how Goku and Vegeta always, they see a big food and they're always eating. They eat so fast. And then you got Aria and Nona just like, that's that. Okay, aside from that, we get to see Aria developing her cosplay skills. Like, she understanding the basics of how to sew, the sewing machine, the body measurement. She did. I know I'm putting punches on her when I say this, but she's outshining Kitagawa. And I'm not saying she's outshining Kitagawa in the rom-com department. I'm talking about experiencing cosplaying. Because you have to remember, Kitagawa can't cosplay. Like, I mean, like, she can cosplay, but she don't know, like, the stitching, all those kind of things to a cosplay. Gojo could do it. Because he's good with dolls, and he knows how to do the measurements. He's good with all that. But I'm talking about, like, experiencing in cosplaying to make your outfits, you know? And the way I saw Aria making her outfits and making her friends, she did a fantastic job dressing up as her favorite character, dressing up as one of the four from the Lily series, which is great. I love it. Now we get to this talk. Let's call like it is. To be honest, guys, I did not expect this cliffhanger. We got so many cliffhangers, it's not even funny. I mean, I thought prison school got more cliffhangers, but this takes the cake. Let me get this straight. She comes home. The mother-in-law, father's mom, called Aria's mom. And we get to see a back shot of Aria's mom in the back. She has black hair. But aside from that, she's going out and say, he died years ago. And I'm like, and Aria's face like, huh? So wait, I was shocked. How are you going to end it like that? How the hell are you going to end it like that? Saying, your father died years ago. Now, here's the thing. There's two-way streets. I'm looking at this. There's a two-way street. On the one hand, I'm thinking to myself, is the wife just saying that just to get on the mother's side, get on the mother-in-law nerves? Or is he actually freaking dead? And just literally, and Aria did not know about it. That's why I'm sitting here. I'm like, Yo, are they serious? Gonna add that? Like, I don't know if he's dead. Like, is the mom just saying that just to piss her off? Or is he actually freaking dead? And you know what? I want to believe that he actually died. And I want to know if that is even possible. Did he die, like, overwork and all that shit? I don't know. But I can't wait to see it. But overall, though, this episode was really good. Really fabricating and really opened up of cosplaying and for Aria's sake. I like how Aria is able to make friends and she's learning how to make cosplay, making outfits and body measurements. I like it. And I also like Mikuri's off-screen things. Like, she finally coming back and now she wants to get close to the MC. And also, her strive for loving the MC. It's kind of like the Gray and Juvia. You know, how Juvia looking at Gray say, Gray sama. I mean, Mikari just doing everything she can to get closer to the MC. It's kind of like the Juvia and Gray effect. But again, this is more about on Aria's sake because, yeah, Aria has cosplay. We get to see her making her outfit. She looked great in her costume. But still, for the ending to go like that, yo, I am questioning on this show. I can't wait to see where this goes. Now, I look forward for next week's episode of it. And again, we're getting closer to the end. So I look forward for next week's episode of it, and I'm sure you will.